Because, of course, what happened with embryonic stem cells was that we had a pretty thorough dialogue with the public. I want to propose to you that every single technology we develop, from the hand axe downwards, has a downside that we forget. Certainly, when we started farming 11,000 years ago, we became much more vulnerable. Certainly, the evidence is that we lived shorter lives. We had more diseases as a result of farming. It's possible that global warming may have changed from the time that we started farming, but certainly we've changed genetic diversity. Cities made disease much worse. You only have to look at the accounts of living in London only in the last century and a half ago to realize how uncivilized a civilized city can be at the average person's level. Transport, energy production, communications, and medicine all have their downside. Particularly, I would argue, medicine, though I'm not going to go into that today. Let's just look at farming. This is Thea Mollison's work at the Natural History Museum, and what she's showing from Abu Huraira in the Middle East is extreme changes in joints, arthritis because of grinding corn, and extremely poor dentition with multiple dental abscesses caused by eating carbohydrates for the first time in large amounts, combined with a certain amount of grit as a result of grinding. But even modern farming has interesting consequences. Let's just look at this slightly funny sound clip. Paula Dean, she calls herself, in her southern drawl. But you might have to be a royal pig to live like one, because the Smithfield farms, for example, have been notorious for the lack of health standards, particularly in Mexico, and the evidence probably is that pig flu, that mutating version of the H1N1 virus, the epicenter was in fact from Veracruz, where Smithfield have their farms, where pigs are left dying amongst mess in the fields. And I think it's quite interesting to consider how they're packed in, and it's not surprising that these mammals convey all sorts of viruses and bacteria in their lifetime and in their death. There is some evidence that the use of antibiotics in animal farming, in the very profligate way we do, has resulted in so much antibiotic resistance in humans. Now, of course, that is controversial, but it doesn't make sense to my mind to risk penicillin-resistant organisms like MRSA and others by giving animals antibiotics which they shouldn't need if we farm them in a proper way, in a human way, and so on, in a humane way. And it's not only animals, mammals, it's also fish. Modern technology has resulted in massive overfishing. This is a paper, a classic paper from Hutchins in Nature, which was published almost exactly 10 years ago to the week. And you can see, I'm sorry, I don't have a laser pointer, so it's a little bit tricky to explain, but if you look at the horizontal dotted line at the cross, these are some 90 species of fish which have been hunted or fished in the seas almost to the point of extinction. And this graph is drawn 10 years after regulation will be brought in. Six species have actually fully recovered. There's been some recovery of about the remaining half, and no recovery at all of the others. Herring, sprat, mackerel, cod, haddock, snapper, redfish and plaice are being hunted to the point of extinction. Now, it's interesting to consider, of course, that one of the alternatives is fish farming as a consequence, and that's been mooted and being used commercially as an alternative way. It's worth bearing in mind that fish constitutes about 8% or 9% of the world's protein intake, and it's particularly important intake in some parts of the world, like, for example, well, let's take Thailand, where, of course, fishing there is very important, but there are many other examples where the volcano has just exploded in Iceland, of course. That's been a critical issue. Fishing has been vital there. But if you fish farm, and it's as old as the Bible, because in Isaiah it's very clear from, I haven't put the actual Hebrew up on the board, but this is the King James's translation. What he's describing here is actually fish farming, because he talks in the next sentence about damming up the Nile. The concept is that fish farming is not new. It's quite an ancient technology. There's a wonderful woodcut by Peter Bruegel. I don't think he cut it himself, but he would have redrawn this from the Hieronymus Bosch picture of fish hunting, if you like. And here in the lower part, you can see the man and his son, the little boy in the boat, holding their fingers out saying, Eki, behold, this is a parable. The big fish eat the little fish. And you can take that as you will in whatever consequence. But of course, it's also showing, of course, that the things that fish eat, isn't that wonderful seeing that mussel trying to eat the fish much bigger than itself in the bottom right-hand corner. But the interesting thing, of course, is that the fish that we most like, trout, salmon, tuna, for example, eat sort of five times their own body weight in other fish. And when we fish farm, of course, what we're doing is feeding them either with fish meal or fish products or plankton or things which are derived from the sea. So actually, in a sense, we are destroying what is an important cycle. And fish farming, even in open waters, around surrounded by nets, produces a massive problem, not least of which is trauma to the fish who are inside those barriers. And fish farming at the moment, on average, has 62,000 fish per hectare. The question of infection and trauma is massive. In Thailand, for example, the lost water resources and the pollution are very considerable indeed, particularly along the coastline. There's the risk of antibiotic resistance again, because antibiotics are given in freshwater fish quite often. And the danger to wild fish is not inconsiderable, because lice and other agents can leak out through the nets, of course, and get into the open sea. I won't deal with calcium loss as a result of possible acidification of the seas, but there are some scientists who believe that we may end up with shellfish which are shell-less as a result of calcium depletion. And of course, there is the question of the cruelty to these fish. Now, one of the points I want to make in this brief talk is the question of where governments come in the control of science. And this photograph is, as you can see in the top right-hand corner, a photograph of Stalin listening to Trofim Lysenko. It's a story I tell in my recent book, Bad Ideas, where Trofim Lysenko, a peasant farmer with no university education, but approved of by the regime because he's not a member of the intelligentsia, has decided that vernalization, that is, modification of the environment of the seed of plants, is all that you need to change its properties as it grow to make a good food stock. Lysenko challenged a massively wonderful geneticist, Andrei Vavilov, who of course was effectively his boss at one time in the Soviet Union, replaced him, and as a result, Stalin's policy was to replant or to plant seeds which failed miserably. Successive failures of plants in the Soviet Union caused millions of deaths, certainly in Kazakhstan, over a million